Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you to our today's presentation. My name is Fabian Konrad from Technical University of Darmstadt, Institute of Materials Technology. Together with my colleague Andreas Pflug, we'd like to give you insight in our project today with the title GPU-based Digital Image Correlation System for Uniaxial and Biaxial Crack Growth Investigations. Our project aims to investigate the influence of far-field multiaxial loading. In the project, we make use of corner crack specimens to gain a uniaxial databases on the crack growth behavior. In a second approach, we use cruciform specimens to investigate the influence of the far-field multiaxiality.
Hello everybody, my name is Andreas Pflug and I am in charge of the Digital Image Correlation System at Fraunhofer IPM. As you see in the video, digital image correlation is a very versatile technique for strain measurement. But it has one major disadvantage, which is that it's too slow. To accelerate it, we used graphics cards. And what we are going to present now is how we use this accelerated GPU-based digital image correlation system for uniaxial and biaxial crack growth investigations. Below you see the samples. The biaxial experiments were carried out in cruciform specimen and the uniaxial ones on corner crack samples. Why is it worth to develop a new GPU-based digital image correlation system? Well, because many crack growth experiments use two sensors for strain measurement. The first one is a mechanical extensometer for strain control, because this has measurement rates in the kilohertz range. The second one is an optical DSC system, because that provides the spatial resolution for crack growth measurements. So a GPU-based DSC system is able to do both strain control and crack growth tracking. Now let's turn to the measurement principle. For fatigue measurements, you need a 2D DSC system. This takes at least two images from the sample surface. One reference image at zero load and one or more measurement images. Within the reference image, you define at least two regions of interest. And within the measurement images, you look for the position of these templates by correlation. The result is a normalized cross-correlation map with a peak, and the position of this peak gives you the displacement of an ROI. By peak fitting, you obtain a subpixel accuracy in the range of 1/20th of a pixel. For strain control, like a mechanical extensometer, you need at least two regions of interest. For strain field measurements, like in the video, you can have many more. On conventional CPU processors, the DSC speed is limited by the correlation calculation. In space domain, the correlation is an n-square process. In Fourier domain, it's an n-log-n process. So for a search area size of 256 pixels, we achieved a correlation rate of 600 correlations per second. A graphics processing unit, GPU, has thousands of processor elements. Therefore, it's a log-n problem, which means acceleration of two orders of magnitude. So there we achieved a correlation rate of up to 50 kilohertz. This means the GPU makes optical DSC extensometers as fast as mechanical extensometers. The left image shows the DSC system in front of the biaxial testing site. The DSC system basically consists of a fast CoaXPress camera, a telecentric lens, and a blue LED illumination. On the right side, you see the camera image. In the center, there is the starting notch for the crack, and At the corners, there are the four regions of interest, which are in the same position as the tips of the mechanical extensometer. In strain control mode, the strain along axis A and B is measured between these ROIs. Depending on the field of view, we achieve measurement rates between 850 Hz and 1.2 kHz. For crack growth investigations, we use the strain field, the green area in the center. Local strain and shear strain are calculated from the displacement. Here you see displacement field in y direction of a corner crack sample. Above the crack you have low displacements and below you have large ones. Local strain is calculated as a convolution between a Sobel operator and the displacement field. And it's divided by the diameter of the Sobel operator, which is four regions of interest here. Similarly, you can calculate shear strain. And in shear strain, you see a maximum above the crack tip and a minimum below. So, if you want to calculate crack depth, you can do that in two different ways. You can define the crack tip position by a threshold in the strain field, which is, of course, load dependent. Or you can use the maximum gradient in shear strain. We compared the resulting crack depth to ACPT measurements. On the left side here you see cross-section through the corner crack sample. The ACPT was calibrated by the surface crack depth, which is here at cycle 0 and here at end of test. The resulting curve is the black curve in the right diagram. The red diamonds are the DSC values measured by thresholding, and the blue dots are those values measured by maximum gradient. Both agree well with ACPD, but we prefer the maximum gradient values to measure crack tip position because they are load independent.
We also like to show you one result of our cruciform specimen testing. Our geometry is depicted here in the left picture. We have two loading axes that we call A and B direction. In the center of the cruciform specimen is a crack starter notch manufactured by eroding. The initial start crack has an incline of 45 degrees. We loaded the specimen in A direction with 35 kN to an R ratio of minus 1, and in the B direction of 17.5 kN also with an A ratio minus 1. The test was carried out with a frequency of 5 Hz. What we saw in the test is that the crack direction turned out to be perpendicular to the highest load. We took the crack direction and the crack itself and applied it to a 2D FEM simulation. The simulation results are depicted here on the right side, where we see the displacements in the U1, that means in A direction. To use the camera most efficiently, we have an angular shift between the camera and our test rig. So I try to depict the loading axis A and B here in the picture. As I said, the crack turned out to grow perpendicular to the highest loading axis B. What we see here is the camera picture overlaid with the DIC evaluation with a divergence U. What we do is we try to recreate the crack path. So we use a skeleton to mask the crack path. In the middle where the crack starter notch is, we fit in a linear interpolation. With that linear interpolation, we do a polynomial fit to the crack itself. So what we see here in the right picture is that we applied polynomial fits of certain degrees from order 5, 7, and 9. The polynomial fit degree 7 fits the crack path here best. When we compare the 2D FEM simulation here on the left side with the DIC evaluation here on the right side, we see that we get quite promising results. So displayed here is the displacement in the A direction, that was the lowest loaded axis. When we measure over the crack, we get a displacement of 19.6 micrometers in the 2D FEM simulation, and we get 29 micrometers over the crack in our DIC evaluation. So we have a difference in crack opening of 1.4 micrometers. What also fits very good is the elongations measured from our extensometer. So our virtual DIC extensometer measures 27.9 micrometers. Our mechanical strain gauge on the specimen applied from the backside measures 29 micrometers. In the FEM, it was a linear elastic FEM simulation, we measured 28 micrometers. When we have a look at the displacements in the higher loaded B direction with 35 kilonewton, we see a crack opening measured here of 4.9 micrometers on the simulation on the left side. In our DIC evaluation on the right side, we measure 5 micrometers. So our displacement differs by 0.5 micrometers, or about 10%. When we look at strain fields, we have the 2D FEM simulation and the DIC evaluation plotted here with the strain in A and B direction. What we see is when we look at the crack tips that we find similar signs for the poles. That means that we do anything right for finding the crack tip. We also see differences in shape and in the magnitudes that are because of the elastic FEM simulation. One different also is the different base length. So in the FEM we used a very finely meshed crack tip with an element size of 2.5 micrometers to gain accurate stress intensity factors. The base length in the DIC is limited to the resolution. In that case we have a base length of 200 micrometers. So what we see here on the slide is an outlook what we're working on today in the upcoming month. So we will use the curl to find the maximum gradient and then the crack tip position. The next step will be to extract a crack tip parameter from the DIC evaluation. We see here on the right side the displacement in the U and also in the V direction. So we will apply algorithms to measure the crack opening displacement in the first step, to calculate the stress intensity factors according to mode 1 and 2. And we also like to evaluate the crack opening and crack closing forces. After that step, we will implement also evaluating domain integrals to evaluate J. To sum up our presentation, we saw that UPU-based DIC enables a combined strain-controlled and full-field strain evaluation in a single sensor. We saw that we had good agreements between the DIC and the ACPD crack depth measurements for our uniaxial corner crack specimens. We gave insight in our cruciform testing and we saw that we have good agreement between the DIC measured, the FEM evaluated, and the extensometer displacement from our mechanical strain gauges. We see that real-time 2D crack growth tracking is still under development to find the accurate crack tip and then to extract crack tip parameters. In a nutshell, we see that GPU-based DIC appears to us as a promising measurement technique for biaxial crack roll investigations. Closing, we like to thank our partners for funding the project, ARIMA. Special thanks go to the BMWi and IGF, and also to all of our industry partners that support the project ARIMA.